first observation is this would be a great place to be a guy going to school. Put that on your recruiting paraphernalia there, Doug. Well, good morning to you. I was pleased to be able to finally put this in the calendar. Patty's tried a couple times, and we just haven't been able to coordinate things. I love talking about the topic of leadership because nobody had, oh, bless you. Actually stopped. Can you imagine this? On the way here, I thought I had plenty of time to get a coffee at McDonald's, but there was a traffic jam downtown Spring Arbor. True statement. Yep. I thought, you know, I could go in there and get here and slide into the classroom right at 7:45 or avoid it and hope that we can find a coffee someplace here. So that's what I chose to do. I'm anxious to engage them with you and your questions, but just give you a little bit of background on me. Born and raised in this area, my wife and I, we were high school sweethearts. This April we'll have been married 42 years. We have three married kids, all blessed to live in the same area, and we have our 12th grandchild on the way. Should be this week or next. And tonight at 7 o'clock, I'll have there's about 21 of them all together at my house because we got this basketball game we want to watch tonight. So I'm kind of anxious to get through the day and get there because not much more fun than doing that with the kids and grandkids. So, and I oftentimes share my business card, and I got something I'm going to give. I think I have one for just about everybody here, but my card, and this side is my state senator card. I call it my nonprofit side. And this side is my business card for my business. I call it my profit side. And I spend about 90% of my time these days on the nonprofit side and about 10% of my time in the business. I was blessed a few years ago this is a true story. And this is something that is not unusual if you're careful what you're looking for. And we're going to talk about, you always find what you're looking for a little bit in a minute. But I was thinking about recruiting somebody that could come and work in the business, that in the event that I chose to do something different, not knowing what that would be, I'd have somebody to lean on. And so I hired two people over the course of about 3 years, and neither one of them worked out very well. At the same time, I was chair of at that time it was Allegiance Health Systems Hospital, and now it's Henry Ford, of course. So I was chair of the board of directors there, and I was recruiting new members. And a cardiologist by the name of Mark Zandi said, Mike is a friend of mine who runs a little manufacturing operation out in Albion. I think he might be interested in serving on the health system board. I said, well, get us in touch with each other. And he gave me his contact. I called Phil. His name is Phil. I called Phil, and we arranged for him to come to my shop to have a get to know each other session. So he came in, and I thought, well, since he's in the manufacturing arena, I thought, go through a little shop tour in my place. If I get 15 minutes, then I'll go in the office and talk about the hospital. Hour and a half later, we get to my office because he's just peppering me with questions. Questions is another topic we're going to talk about. Sit down and he says, okay, so tell me about this hospital board gig. I said, I'm sorry, Phil. Remember, this is the very first time I've met this fellow. I said, sorry, Phil, it's not going to work out. And he got this queried look on his face, and he says, what do you mean? I thought we were going to talk about the hospital board spots. I says, I'm just sorry, it's just not going to work out very well. He said, well, what do you mean? I said, because we both can't be gone at the same time. And it took him a minute. He says, are you offering me a job? I said, yes, sir, I am. 2 weeks later, he started, and this is his 12th year. And only because of Phil Sponsler am I able to do the job in the center that I'm doing. I shouldn't say only because my family's been strongly behind me, but identifying key people and following your gut is a key part of leadership. You ladies in the room, God has given you very unique skill sets in terms of intuition. Another lesson for you guys, once you get a girlfriend or once you get married, learn quickly, because it took me about 25 years. That oftentimes my wife will tell me I should or shouldn't do something, not be able to explain why. And every time I've not done what she's recommended, I've regretted it. Little things and some big things. God is especially gifted women on intuition. So we think we can figure everything out, but they just know it. So my hat's off to you ladies. So it's 2009. After over about 20 years, every now and then I'd bring up the topic of running for office, and every time, this is after I'd learned the lesson about listening to my wife, every time I brought it up, she'd say, I don't think so, it doesn't feel right. So I didn't. Then November 2009, I brought it up again for probably the 15th time, and she says, well, maybe. And then, unfortunately, and this is not something I bring up too often, the fellow who I would be going to be running against died completely unexpectedly. And so we viewed that as not as a take advantage of somebody else's misfortune, but just her saying maybe and that occurring, decided it was the right time to do so. So I've been in office since 2010. 2 years or two terms of two-year terms in the House, and now I'm in my first term. First and four-year term in the Senate. I chose to specialize in the legislature in the areas of energy and healthcare. Energy kind of relates to my engineering background in healthcare because I served for so many years on the health system board and spent so much time learning all the acronyms. I figured I shouldn't throw that education away. And so, and it's been a blessing to be able to do that. Let's open it up for questions. I think you've been assigned, made an assignment to ask questions. So let's go from there. Who's going to be the brave one to start? When you start, please give me your first name. I'm sorry, Sasha. Thank you, Sasha. Say diversity? Yeah. But we don't have to worry about too much about diversity in the Senate because we have a wide range of colleagues. I have a wide range of colleagues that have been successful in running. And they pretty much represent the diversity of their own districts that they represent. So we've got, I'm trying to think here, we have African American, we have Arabs, we have a lot of Jewish folks that have run for office. We have two Chinese nationals that have become American citizens. I'm kind of going through my seating assignment, because we have a seating assignment. But we have a terrific diversity in the House and Senate. In the workplace, we don't have a specific stated goal on diversity, other than anybody that comes in the door is welcome to engage in a conversation about what are the skills that we need in the business. And we encourage everybody to fill out an application if they meet those initial hurdles, both of our interest and of their skill sets. And then we don't have a very diverse workforce at Orbicorn. I don't consider male and female diversity. That's just, we got lots of ladies working with us. We don't have a lot of minorities. And we have one fellow that is Japanese that graduated from Kettering University, which is my alma mater. Was General Motors Institute at one time. But we don't have a lot of diversity there. It's not by choice, it's just by... I think it's exceedingly important in the legislative arena, and I value that highly. In the workplace, to me, it's more of we don't do a lot of interaction with the community, because it's almost all engineering. Everybody's kind of their own island of a workplace, their own productivity unit, if you will. And so I think diversity always adds richness to an environment, but I haven't noticed needed to set it as a priority in the business world. Now, a larger company is particularly one that interacts with the public. I think it's extremely important. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Yes, sir. I'm going to tell you thing that was the biggest surprise in a very good way is, you know, we all have our own opinions, right, based on what we see in the media, read the media about politicians. It's a pejorative. That word is a pejorative, right? And I thought I was going to be entering into an arena where a bunch of self-centered, angry, bigoted folks. And what I found was, first of all, the biggest surprise was the number of true Christian believers that are serving in office. I can't speak for the rest of the nation, but for the Michigan House and the Michigan Senate, it's awesome. We have Bible studies almost every morning if you want to go. We pray a lot. Yesterday, we've got a colleague he's the chief of staff of the Senate Majority Leader, who's suffering with a real bout of cancer. And we thought he was doing pretty good, but yesterday he texted me and says, I need prayer, Mike, because I'm on my way to Ann Arbor. And so we stopped in the middle of a meeting, a very contentious meeting, frankly. And that text message kind of served two purposes. You know, it allowed us to stop and pray for Craig, but it also kind of helped reset the tone of the meeting we were having. So that's one of the best surprises. Biggest lessons that I've learned is that you can't be an expert in every field, and you have to become skilled at identifying who are the experts. I'll give you a couple of examples. I openly say I don't spend a lot of time paying attention to agricultural issues, and I don't spend a lot of time focusing on education issues, because I've identified colleagues who are experts and have deep experience in those two areas. And so that was one of the biggest lessons, is because it was frustrating. We're being asked to vote on a wide, an almost infinite breadth of variety of topics. There's no way you can be an expert in all of them. And so we all kind of create our own paths, our own ruts in the road, and kind of stay in those. And as I mentioned to you earlier, mine is energy and healthcare. So I told you I got another card to hand out. I don't know if I got enough cards for everybody. Give me a favor and pass them out. Thanks. One of my frustrations is people, and this is to me the two key parts about two key points about leadership that I think if I had to share anything, it'd be these two. Number one is to learn to ask questions that cannot be answered yes or no. Learn to ask questions that cannot be answered yes or no. That has been especially helpful to me in the Senate and in the legislature, but it was incredibly helpful to me in business when I was starting my business. I didn't know much about my customers when I started my business. I knew a lot about the product that we're building. We build orbital forming and fastening machines, and that doesn't mean anything to you. But basically, if you've got a recliner chair at home, a lazy boy chair, or something like that, and if you pull the lever or press the button and the foot mechanism goes out to support your legs, the pivot points in that are rivets that have been formed to allow that mechanism to operate, and our machines form those rivets so that it's not too tight, so you can go out in and out easy, and not too loose, so it's sloppy. And that's a very narrow niche product. And when I started the business, I was 29 years old, and we have two employees, if you count me, and going out to customers and trying to demonstrate and prove that I had enough knowledge that they could expect that we could deliver the, whatever we're promising, I quickly discovered that I couldn't establish that credibility unless I could speak the language, the customer's language, and each customer had their own language. And I quickly then learned that the best way for me to learn their language is to ask them questions that they couldn't answer yes or no. And it demonstrated two things. One, that I was interested in them versus trying to prove that they should be interested in me. And it also allowed me to, as I captured their responses, I was able to craft the questions back to them in their language. And it, to them, it showed that I apparently knew what I was talking about. I say apparently because for the first few years, I probably didn't. So learning to ask questions that cannot be answered yes or no is a critical process that I really recommend you fine-tune it. It's also terrific when you're raising kids. And the other one is on the back of that card, that acronym stands for you always find what you're looking for. I don't care what arena, whether it's you coming into this classroom this morning, or you going home tonight, wherever you're going to go, going to church on Sunday, whatever. We always find what we're looking for. I know when I go home at night, if I don't have my attitude adjusted properly, I'll find things that bother me, for instance. Or if I go home tonight and say, you know, I'm going to find three ways to compliment Sue, that's my wife, it's easy to find them when I'm looking for them. It's the same way with employees and the same way with opportunities. When a problem arises either at work or in the Senate, it can be viewed as an opportunity or a problem. And to me, it's all dependent upon what you're looking for. You always find what you're looking for. Not sometimes. Always find what you're looking for. I just have another question. Yes, sir. First name? Cole? Good questions, both all across the board. Our paths of interest cross based on the question you asked. I also chair a committee called the Michigan Competitiveness Committee. And actually, I created the committee 4 years ago in the House. This is kind of an interesting story. So politics does revolve around money. I will tell you that there's a lot of money involved in buying influence. And it would have been four and a half years ago. Ran successfully for a second term in the House, and I had my eye on being chair of the Energy Policy Committee. But in energy policy, the primary things you work on are things related to energy, electricity, gas, and so forth. And the one industry and two companies that have a great interest in that area because they're heavily regulated are, of course, Consumers Energy, which we're blessed to have them service us in this area, and DTE. They're both very politically active, and on a couple of issues that hit home for them, one on the topic of customer choice, I'm not exactly aligned with their thinking, because customer choice causes them to have to compete on a more rigorous basis, and it kind of plays in their sandbox, let's put it that way. So they were very effective in influencing the Speaker of the House to not select me as Chair of Energy, although I had the opportunity to talk to the Speaker, Cole. I said, all right, his name is Jace. Jace, you tell me why I'm not the most a qualified guy for energy chair. I didn't ask him, do you think I'm qualified or not qualified? I said, tell me why I'm not the most qualified. And the bottom line was, he got influenced by the contribution to the utilities and selected another guy. He says, why don't you create your own committee? That was his challenge back to me. I said, okay. So I give it a couple days thought and come up with this Michigan Competitiveness Committee. And the definition or the mission of that committee is to identify unfettered where Michigan either is competitive and how can we be more, or we're not competitive and how do we resolve it. So this month we're going to have committee meetings. This is directly to your point, Cole, your question, Cole. So there's still a out of balance amount of venture capital investment on the coasts and a dearth of it in the Midwest, although it's growing. So we've got a couple of venture capital firms from the coast coming in to committee to ask them, and I've already teed them up with three or four of the questions they're going to ask. To ask them that question is, why is that out of balance and what can we do to change it? Having also had said that, I think Michigan is a fertile ground, particularly for products related to transportation, of course, but also for anything in manufacturing. We, in not just Michigan, but where you're sitting right now, within a 10-mile radius, there's no manufacturing process that you can't find world-class expertise on, with a possible exception of electronic manufacturing. And there's even some electronics manufacturing within 10 miles of here, but it may not compete on a global basis with some of the things that you can get out of Japan and Indonesia and Asia. But everything else within 10 miles of here, there's nothing you can't find in the manufacturing realm that isn't world class. And so I think Michigan's very fertile. And I also believe that within your guys' lifetime, maybe not mine, is Michigan's uniqueness from the standpoint that we have an abundant and near infinite supply of fresh water is going to be a leveraged asset that we can't even project how valuable that's going to be. Nor can we project how much energy we're going to put into protecting it, because there's going to be lots of people who are going to want it. So I think Michigan, and I'm a little prejudiced, I'll admit that, but I think Michigan is uniquely qualified in that area. And plus, also within a pretty small radius, we have, you know, some unbelievably high world-class education institutions. Of course, the center of it, of course, is Spring Arbor, right? I mean, that's the nucleus. The center is the nucleus. So yeah, I think it's a great place to. And the resources available for consulting and for testing ideas, it's all about networking, though. All about finding what you're looking for. All right, who's next? Yes, sir.
Jim, would you say the struggle of
first of all, I want to make it clear that I don't think special interests are deviant. I don't think they're bad. We all have special interests, okay? And so we all have the right to defend or advocate for or campaign for or lobby for our special interests. So I don't want to leave the impression that it's something that is immoral. It's not. I'm sorry, but I'm going to go back to the, you know, yesterday was a, I'm going to give you an example and take you through the meeting. Actually, the meeting that I was in that was getting a little bit contentious when I got a text from my friend that was going to Ann Arbor, it was over this topic of a mid-level provider in the dental arena. It's healthcare related. And so, you know, there's physicians have physician assistants and advanced practice nurses in their offices. Those are called extenders. They're called mid-levels or extenders. And they allow physicians to treat and see more people and then spend their time in the areas where they're uniquely skilled, particularly in the primary care arena. So in the dental arena, yeah, we've all gone to dentists, and there's dentists, and then there's dental assistants and dental hygienists. Dental assistants require virtually no training other than on-the-job experience. Hygienists, a couple of years of training. So in many states across the nation, they're introducing and have introduced a mid-level provider in the dentistry field called dental therapist. It's a master's degree level training, and it's intended to provide dentists with yet another tool so they can see more people and delegate some of the things that dental therapists are trained to do. But in every case in the political arena, when somebody's trying to do something new, that means somebody else's sandbox is being played in. And nobody likes their sandbox played in. Okay? So in this case, it's dentists. Now, we all have dentists, right? Dentists are some of the more friendly providers that we know. They're our friends, they're family members, and they don't like the fact that somebody is playing in their sandbox. And so the lobbying for the dental therapist is on one side of the table, and the lobbyist for the dentist is on the other side of the table. I chair the Health Policy Committee. I'm the sponsor of the bill that would create a mid-level provider in the dental arena, dental therapy. And I got one member of the Health Policy Committee who I need to get her support to be able to get enough momentum to get it out of committee. So I asked her if she would invest time to learn more, because she was been a no, mostly because of her dentist telling her she shouldn't vote yes. And I says, but she's a sharp gal. And I said, Margaret, would you please invest some time to learn about this? I'm not going to ask you to vote one way or the other. I want to make sure you know what you're voting on and not just relying upon rumor or opinion of your dentist. And she said yes. And so we had a meeting yesterday. We literally had, and it was not a public meeting. We have committee meetings are public. And so in those meetings, some people are a little reluctant to, you know, go open kimono and explain, you know, really share their opinion. So we had a meeting in Margaret's conference room. And it got a little heated, okay? And so the way I was able to influence the way Margaret processed the differences is, again, by asking questions that couldn't be answered yes or no, particularly of those that were advocating and lobbying for the dentists. And they were going through their objections to creating a mid-level. And I said, well, why don't you explain to us where your position would be if we eliminated these two objections? And I'm not going to get into the detail of the objections. I said, tell us about that. Dead silence. Dead silence. So then I had to ask him a question that could be answered yes or no. I said, so are you telling me by your silence that if we eliminated these two obstacles, which you have said are your primary objections, that you still would oppose the bill? Yes, we still oppose the bill. So I just turned to Margaret and I says, I have no other questions, Margaret. What about you? So getting back to your point, Jim, your question, how do I best influence my colleagues? It's not by arm twisting. It's by trying to understand very clearly where their mind is. And in her case, she would be relying on just one side of input, getting in an environment where she could see both sides, and then asking the questions of the two sides, leading them into exposing the truth, really, in a non-threatening environment. And then, what I've showed to Margaret was that I wasn't there to bend her arm into a position. I was there to enable her to make a decision. And I told her before we started, Margaret, I don't care if you're yes or no. I just want you to know why you're yes or no. I find that has worked. There are a few issues that you can't, you know, people have a visceral opposition to or a position on. I was the lead member of the House in 2011 when we became a right-to-work state. See you, Doug. Thank you. We became a right-to-work state. Nobody in the world ever thought Michigan would be a labor freedom state where unions are as free to make their case as workers are to make their choice. And that issue, that's a good example of an issue where there's no gray area. You're either on one side or the other, and it was really just a matter of trying to muster enough support to get one vote beyond majority to get it done. But demonstrating first that you're interested before expecting to be interesting is really what we're talking about here with colleagues. And there's no, you know, you can, leadership is far less about the statements you're willing to make and far more about the courage of asking the right questions. And I've discovered that in many cases. You really can't reveal the obstructions or the opposition to change without asking the questions so you can understand what they are to be able to overcome them. What questions do you have, Tanya? All right. Lydia. Yes, ma'am. Complete loss of your calendar. I have no control of my calendar. It is a frustration that I deal with daily. And if there's anything that causes me to kind of lose my composure or just get frustrated or get mad, is when I pull out my phone, wherever is that here, and I pull up the calendar and I look at I look at today, and there's no end. There's no end. There's not 1 minute today that's not scheduled other than my drive from here to Lansing. That is the one thing that drives me crazy, because in the business world, particularly as being the owner, I had complete and total freedom. And it was pretty easy for me to say no to anything I want to say no to and yes to things I want to say yes to. And if I didn't want to do something, it was no problem. And this arena, there is infinite demand for your time. And you just have to work closely with your staff so they can understand where your priorities are. But even then, there's infinite demand. So that's the number one biggest frustration and the toughest transition from the private world to the public sector. I mean, tonight, I'm going to, I have four different things I should do tonight at 7 o'clock. And so three of them I'm saying no to because I'm going home to watch the basketball game, you know. But that means that I got to do some relationship building in the three things that I'm choosing to not do. And I usually do the other things, but this one, you know, is kind of a family deal, but. It's a major frustration for me, and it's what my wife will know. She says, you need to take a day off. Saturdays are full. Sundays aren't. Thankfully, Sundays aren't. But the complete loss of the calendar, because somebody else has got control of your priorities, is the biggest transition and the biggest frustration. Ma'am. Autumn. A lot of my colleagues talk about the political realm for a moment. A lot of my colleagues, I'm really blessed because it's 59 minute drive from home to Lansing for me. A lot of my colleagues, it's 2-3-4 hour drive, and some of them, when it gets beyond 3 hour drive, they spend the night in Lansing, so they're away from home. So I leverage that 59 minutes in both directions. I have a couple of podcast stations that I listen to that are inspirational stations. Dr. David Jeremiah is who I listen to every morning on the way to Lansing. And I love his messages and his preaching. And then, you know, on a pretty regular basis, well, almost every week, I go to the Wednesday morning Bible study. Bunch of colleagues, led by a colleague out of the house. But beyond that, it's stopping. You know, when I got a pretty good sense of when I'm being tested. And I unplug for a minute, go to my office, close the door, pray, ask for wisdom. Even my staff, my chief of staff, she's a gal who has intuition that I wished I had. And she'll say, hey, Mike, you need to slow down for a moment. So that's what I do. And everybody has, I think, a different approach. I really, for the first couple of years, I didn't enjoy that drive, and now I've figured out a way to make it a productive time. Instead of listening to the radio and all the chaos and all the noise. And then I also my preferred choice for exercise is walking. I got knee injuries from football that I can't. I think running. I believe running's an unnatural act, actually. You know, so I can't run, but I can walk forever. And so my choice of exercise is walking. And again, I have my favorite podcast that I listen to while I'm walking, or I just listen to Christian music. Yes, ma'am. I forgot, what's your first name? Haley, thank you. Yeah, and this is a little uncomfortable to talk about. I hesitate to tell you about this a little bit because I don't want to add to any prejudices you may have about politics. Some of them are deserved, but not all. Most of my colleagues that I work with, guys and gals, they're doing it out of a passion for service, but there's a few that don't, and then there's also a few in the arena that are trying to advocate for things that they're being paid to advocate for. That they get sometimes desperate. And so, you know, I've had a couple of rather uncomfortable experiences with female lobbyists that have crossed the line and where I've had to back out of the situation and say, tell my staff I can't meet with them again unless there's somebody else present. I don't want to get into any more detail than that, but you can fill in the blank a little bit, you know. So very careful about who I'm alone with. And I just make it a policy now. I don't go to lunch with a lady alone. I go to lunch with ladies. That's no problem. But I don't go to lunch with a lady alone anymore. It was hard. It's just very uncomfortable. Yes, sir. Seek first to understand before endeavoring to be understood is one of my favorite leadership principles, and it has to do with this business about asking questions and refining your ability to ask questions. But seek first to understand before endeavoring to be understood has served me well in both arenas, both the private sector and the public sector. When somebody comes into my office in the public sector, again, lobbyists, advocating, we'll come back to you in a minute, Cole, don't worry, for something that they think I'm going to be naturally opposed to, I calm them right down. I says, don't assume that you know where I'm at on this, because I'm not even sure where I'm at. Let's just peel back the onion here. so I can understand what it is, what's the problem you're trying to solve or the opportunity you're trying to exploit, and what does good look like as a result. In every case, when it comes to legislation, in every case when it comes to advocating for a change in policy, it's driven by one of those two things. Somebody's trying to solve a problem or exploit an opportunity, and exploit in this case is not a pejorative. Exploit can be a good way to exploit an asset, for instance, okay? But in every case in legislation, it's either one of two things, trying to solve a problem or exploit an opportunity. But oftentimes, nobody takes the time to define what the real root problem is. And that's one of the areas of expertise that I've, mostly because of my engineering background, but it's also something that I've refined over time. And that's related to the business about learning how to ask questions, is what is the real root problem it's trying to solve? You don't ask simple questions, do you? I get that. Okay, so I'm a technology guy. I love technology. But I also recognize that technology can be used for good and for bad. And I believe, this is in my heart, that the divide that is growing in our culture, like political culture, and in some ways, even in our social mores, can be traced back to social media and giving every person a loud voice, in my mind, an undeserved loud voice. I got a couple of guys that are groupies that follow me on social media and everything I say and everything I do, and they're just the vitriol is beyond measure. And I think that has what's created the ability, the growth in the chasm, because people have a voice and they can project it in a way that they never could before. Freedom has two dimensions: freedom to succeed and freedom to fail. You can't have one without the other. And if in the case of government, if we spend all of our time and all of our energy and all of taxpayer money on eliminating all the opportunities for freedom to fail, I mean, but ultimately what that means is just regulate everything. The only sure outcome is we'd eliminate the opportunities for freedom to succeed. And that is an unresolvable. I think that is as true as gravity. Freedom has two dimensions: freedom to succeed and freedom to fail. And if we try to eliminate, protect people from the freedom to fail, all we will end up doing is minimizing the opportunities for freedom to succeed. In other words, we put shackles on people and become a very, very unfree environment. What was the second part of your question? Whatever changes that I think is going to happen is going to be temporary, because just about like everything else in life, it's a pendulum. And we'd love in life for our pendulum to stand static in the middle, but it never will be. It'll always be swinging one way or the other. I'll give you an example on healthcare, because it's an easy one for me to talk about. About 20 years ago, there was a lot of studies made that the medical world was not doing a good job of acknowledging and treating pain. Actually, it's about 25 years ago. We were not doing, somebody decided that we were not doing a good job of treating pain. That was when the pendulum was over here. And so it became a priority, a talking point. It even became a question that insurance companies would survey their clients and hospitals would survey their patients on pain management. That's when the opioid problem made its weird, ugly head. And so now, what happened as a result of that is, you know, when you go to the hospital today, you're sitting in there, you got a whiteboard there in almost every hospital room. And one of the questions that they're required to ask you every day is, are you satisfied? I'm sorry for sounding like I'm repeating myself, but it's really important for you to understand the power of questions. The question that you'll be asked today is, are you satisfied with the way your pain is being managed? Scale of 1 to 10. The inference there, of course, is you should have no pain. And so if somebody says, I'm not satisfied, they're going to give you more to suppress your pain. And that is what has driven the overuse of painkillers, particularly opioid-based painkillers. The pendulum now has gone all the way over the other way, where we're over-prescribing. Okay? If the question had been, are you satisfied with how your pain is being managed? If the question had been, are you satisfied with how your options for pain management were explained to you? Completely different trajectory, completely different outcome. Because in the second question, it infers that when a physician or a nurse is going to offer you, explain to you your pain options, when they talked about, you know, we could, if your pain's bad enough, we could give you oxycodone or an opioid-based painkiller. But you need to know that there's proven science that we each have unique opioid receptors in our brains, and you know, we can't predict if you're susceptible to being addicted to it. But it changed the world completely, but we didn't. We asked the wrong question and drove the responses in the wrong direction. That's one of my two biggest areas of focus, by the way, right now, is finding a safe landing. This is in the political arena again, a safe landing on healthcare, particularly with regards to the Medicaid population and opioids. And this afternoon at 2:30, I'm in a press conference with the governor. We're going to be announcing a complete suite of new legislation related to opioid abuse and trying to arrest it. I've divided it into four categories: minimizing the supply, increasing the education and responsibility, offering different treatments, and then empowering enforcement. That's the entire spectrum of opioid abuse. And we've got legislation kind of addressing all four of those categories. I kind of got off on a rabbit trail a little bit on your question. Excuse me for that. I think you, didn't you assign everybody to have a question?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Yes, ma'am. Kara. Yeah. I don't travel as much as I'd like. This job, again, not just my daily calendar, but the yearly calendar is pretty much consumed. But I'll let you in on a little secret. That week from Sunday, Sue and I are leaving to go for 2 weeks. It's a spring break in the legislature. So we're leaving on a week from Sunday to go 2 weeks to Hilton Head. It's kind of our favorite spring place to go. I didn't tell you that, you know, my hobbies are woodworking and bow hunting. I'm an avid bow hunter. My wife says that I'm a rabid bow hunter. So she's probably more right than I am. I just, this last year, in July of 2016, I spent 13 days in Africa and bow hunting, and pretty successful time. But my favorite place to visit, and I've only been there twice, I'm going back in July 16th of this year, is Israel. And to me and put it on your bucket list, particularly for those of us who have, you know, a desire to build that core foundation of our faith. There's nothing like walking through Jerusalem or out in the outskirts of the Sea of Galilee, or climbing up the steps of Masada and having the Bible become real right before your eyes. There's nothing like that. And so I strongly encourage you to put it on your list to try to get there. And they are, the Israeli folks are very welcoming to tourists. And I've been twice, and the guides we've had have been Jewish. In one case, was a non-practicing Jew. Brilliant guy. And I've never met anybody that knew the Bible like he knew the Bible. He's not a Christian, but he knew the Bible inside and out. So that's my answer to my. I'm kind of a homebody, though. I'll tell you, I enjoy being home. I got this awesome workshop that I built when we built our house. That I just finished a live edge. It took me a year. I found a maple tree that's 60 inches in diameter. I tried to count the rings on it. I think it was like 180 years old. And I got a slab out of this maple tree and made a live edge table. Dining room table. It's 11 foot long. It's pretty cool. It's pretty cool. It took me a year to do it. So, well, that's a good question too. When we first started, because it was green, it took four guys to move it. But the way I built it, it had, you know, a top, two legs, and a stringer, and it was all disassembled. And so the top weighed 280 pounds, and me and my hunting buddy, we moved it. Well, my wife wasn't home because she told me I shouldn't. She is. She's really smart. Yeah, she sure is. Yes, ma'am. What's the advice for team management, particularly when all the members of the team's opinions vary? My advice to that is, we'll just assume that we'll take it issue by issue, whatever the team is dealing with, right? And so, this is going to sound like a broken record, okay? What's the problem we're trying to solve, or the opportunity we're trying to exploit? Sometimes the problems are verbalized in a goal we're trying to achieve, okay? So that could be the problem. But seeking to find common understanding and agreement on what is the goal or the problem we're trying to solve. Not the symptoms of the problem, but the core problem. And when everybody in that team can begin to nod their heads that they agree on this definition of the problem, then you move to, well, what does good look like if we're successful? WDGLL. I'm kind of proud of the fact that most of my colleagues now actually use that acronym, WDGL. What does good look like? When they actually come to my office, lobbyists actually say, well, here's what good looks like. Because oftentimes people don't take the time. You know, they may have a sense of what the problem is, and they may have an idea of what their outcome is, but they can't articulate it. So I actually use what does good look like for every meeting. Yesterday, for instance, I had two lobbyists represent the healthcare industry for the certificate of need specifically, and they know I'm kind of a freedom guy. You know, you probably guessed that by now. And I don't think certificate of need, basically what that means is you have to have permission to install an MRI machine, or you have to permission to put 10 new beds in your hospital. And you have to get a certificate of need approval for doing that. And I think that's unnecessary. Anyway, we started the meeting, and they know where I'm at on that, and they're pro-COM, pro-student. And said, okay, fellas, before we get started here, what does good look like for this meeting? Actually, a better example, because that one was pretty clear, earlier in the day yesterday, I had a bunch of people come in from behavioral health industry, freestanding behavioral health mental hospitals, what they were. Never met these people before. Didn't know any of their names, and really was not familiar with what their issues were, which are my favorite meetings. But I started the meeting by asking the question, what is good like look like at the end of this meeting, and have them say to me, well, what we would like to do, what we would like to accomplish at the end of this meeting is that you, A, agree to come visit one of our facilities this summer, B, better understand our issues, and C, help us identify where funding can be affected. I mean, they articulated, but without asking that question, we've been just talking. Big waste of time if you don't spend time doing that. But in a group, in a team, focus on what's the goal you're trying to accomplish, what's the problem you're trying to solve, what's the opportunity you're trying to exploit. And if you can get common understanding on that, you can build from there. And if you can get common understanding, there's a reason for that. You know, and so we should be spending far more of our time defining problems and far less of our time on a percentage basis working on solutions. Because the more time we invest in defining problems, the higher the probability that the solution is going to be good and work. So where you get, what level are you guys? Juniors, seniors, juniors mostly, sophomores. Are you a Smith? No, I'm talking to this guy right here. Yeah, are you a Smith? Okay, all right. You look like a Smith to me. So. A friend of mine that his kids are Smith, so not that you look like a Smith, but a specific one. Yes, ma'am. Matthew 20:24 through 26, it can be paraphrased as he who is greatest among them is first servant of all. And I think that applies in both arenas, demonstrating to those in the private sector that you're just as interested in their success as your success, and in the public sector, demonstrating that you're just as interested as what their interests are as your interests are, and trying to find ways to help them achieve their goals. And that both are servant leadership kind of orientations. I didn't share with you that there are basically three entities or three people that, for the most part, have the final say in what happens politically in Michigan. It's the governor, Speaker of the House, and the Senate Majority Leader. They meet weekly, set priorities, negotiate, and really set the tenor for going forward. And so I am actively campaigning to be the next Senate Majority Leader, which would be 2 years from now. And, you know, it's from this area, from the Jackson Hillsdale area, it's kind of a big deal. We've not had anybody from this area that level of influence in state government since Governor Blair was governor, who's from Jackson, you know, 100 years ago. And I'm getting back to your question. And so the Senate Majority Leader is elected by other senators. It's not a public vote. It is a private vote. And so, you know, you got to earn the right to get your colleagues' votes. And it's all about, in my mind, there's two ways to do it. One pathway, which is often followed, is you raise a bucket of money, boatload of money, and you pass out money to your colleagues so that you can help them in their election or re-election efforts. My choice and my pathway is to demonstrate that I am more interested in their success than mine, in understanding their route, what they want to achieve, what they want to get out of their investment of time in the Senate, and, you know, proving that I'm strategic and can execute a plan and, you know, earning their confidence that whatever they say they want to achieve, I can be a tool for them to achieve that. And again, that's just another subset of servant leadership.
Okay.
Okay, good questions. What caused me to want to get in politics is, it's real simple. I've said this 100 times on the campaign trail. I was too young for Vietnam and too old for everything else. And so I've never actually have had to serve. And I feel like we all have a responsibility to find a way to serve. Now, I am in no way equating running for office the same as running, serving in the military and putting your life at risk, although there have been some town halls where I thought that might be the case. But no, I'm not equating that. But it is a sacrifice. It is a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice for your family. I've already talked about the sacrifice of your schedule, your personal life. And we're blessed, and our business is pretty successful. But I know that there are opportunities that have been not taken full advantage of because I haven't been in the business, on a day in and day out basis. But it was a need, a visceral need for me to say I made a contribution. Now my hope is it's a good contribution. What was the second part of your question? Yeah. I love, our office is known throughout both the House and Senate as we're a gravitational attraction to all either the highly contentious issues or the highly complex issues. I love complex puzzles. That's one of the reasons I like healthcare, because it's an infinitely complex puzzle. We have this, I say healthcare, energy, and education all suffer from the same malady. Healthcare, education, and energy all suffer from the same malady. We all expect them to be driven by, I won't speak for all of you, but I'll just say I expect them to be driven by capitalistic incentives, competition, those that can that deliver the services, the highest quality, best cost, best value, win. So we expect the services to be delivered, education, healthcare, and energy, delivered in a capitalistic environment. Yet we all expect them to be provided with socialistic expectations. We want everybody to have the same access to energy, everybody to have the same access to education, and everybody to have the same access to health care. That's a big conflict. That's why those three areas are so complex. Capitalistic expectations, and I'm going to put it in the form of an engineering model here, metaphor. Capitalist expectations is this gear, and capitalistic driven incentives is this gear, socialistic expectations is this gear, and those gears just don't mesh very well. And that's why those three areas are so complex, the solutions are so hard. And two of those three are my specialties, healthcare and energy. Education I stay away from because it's, one of the things that's been interesting to your question about what was fascinating observations is when you first run for office and you're with your first freshman class, everybody, when you ask committees you want to serve on, almost everybody, the first term, writes down education. It's because we figured we went to school and must be experts in education. I quickly learned I wasn't. And so I've picked out colleagues that I think are, and I kind of follow them, but I like complex puzzles. This opioid epidemic is one of those, and I've just completely invested myself and my staff into trying to define the root problems. Again, I have a colleague who introduced a piece of legislation that has to do with this issue that would mandate that physicians use the electronic Michigan Automated Prescription System, MAPS, whenever they prescribe drugs, including, especially, of course, opioids. And if they don't use the system, it's a felony. Now, just think about that for a minute. Mandating the use of something, and if you don't use it, it becomes a felony. And this is a good example of where I'd like to inject myself and say, okay, if that's a good idea, what are the requirements for it to be something that would actually end up being useful? And what the requirements are that physicians need to want to embrace that system, because otherwise they won't want to use it, and then we'll be creating felonies unnecessarily. That is an example of a really complex issue. Nobody disagrees that we should have control and record when we're opioids are being prescribed. But I say we've got to be awfully careful if we're going to put a law on the books that makes it a felony if we don't, you know, don't use a specific system that's being designed by the government. I got 55 minutes to get to Lansing. And that's a 52-minute drive from here. So I think I'm going to ask for an exit right now, if that's okay, Patty. Is that all right?
Yeah, all right.
Yeah. So I want to thank you for allowing me to come in your classroom this morning. I hope we didn't get off to a too slow a start. I hope you were able to ask the questions that, you know, were on your heart. And I hope that you sincerely take from here my exhortation to you, and that is, don't underestimate the power of refining your skill sets in asking questions. Thank you very much. Thanks, Patty.